Okay, so I guess we'll start, although people are still coming in. I'll start with the boring part, introducing myself, so it's not a big deal. Pero primero, hola a todos. Estoy muy, muy, muy contento de ser aquí con vosotros, estar aquí con vosotros. Pero ya aún no me atreví a dar esto en español, así que back to English. A clean, pragmatic architecture, right? How we should think as software craftsmen to do these, to emerge this architecture in a clean way. But first, let me ask you several questions. If you have something that you cannot avoid doing, but you must do, but that annoys you, what do you do? Well, the first thing a human would do is to, postpone it, right? We'll do it tomorrow. And then you become a manager, a boss, a tech lead. Then what do? You delegate it, of course, right? But that's not the correct way of behaving, right? As professionals, what we should do when something annoys us is to do it more often, which is actually the philosophy behind extreme programming. Bring the pain forward. When you are working on your own branch for 2 weeks and then you merge, how does it feel? Oh my God, red, right? Then what do they say? Continuous integration, push every 15 minutes, every hour, okay? Every day at least. Then what does it feel after you do a pull request when they call you in for a code review? How does it feel? Oh my God, huh? You are going there, oh my God. So what do they say instead? Do pair programming, let another human look at your code before you ever put it in written, right? Design your code together with someone else, do pair programming. Quick check, how many of you have ever tried pair programming? Yes, I love you guys, good. So then we'll do this more fast, right? Then, how does it feel when you end up with some code which was never refactored? Oh my God. Instead, continuous refactoring. Never push some code unless it is worth putting it next to your CV, right? This is how I write code, code sample. This is how the code should look when you push. And lastly, with no tests, that's the ultimate horror, right? The ultimate horror movie. You end up with some project with zero unit tests. What do they say instead? Test first. How many of you have ever practiced? How many of you practice now test-driven development? Woohoo! Okay, so then, next question: are you agile? At least where I came from, by agile they mean throwing tasks at us while still meeting the same deadline, and they are just shoveling new tasks on the. This is our feeling of agile. This is not what agile really was at its origin. So instead of that, software craftsmanship is there to vive la résistance, right? To keep up the pace and to return the focus on the technical practices. Okay. In this happy tone, I'm Victor. I'm a Java champion and I'm a lead architect at IBM. But don't imagine me drawing diagrams. No, I am doing. That's what the fireman is for. Wherever there are problems, where is Victor? So I'm mostly basically a consultant internally. I am also practicing these weird things as you do, so yeah, respect. This stuff, pair programming, refactoring. And I've also talked a lot about clean code, and many. The point of this slide is, however, that I have a website on which you can find the best talks that I did until now. I've started training, that's what I love doing most, training, first inside my company, and then for some other companies throughout Europe now. I've started with some basic topics, and I encourage you all to start teaching yourselves to the newcomers, to the juniors, to the interns in your company. These are easy to learn, easy to teach. Then design patterns, TDD, architecture, clean code, this kind of stuff. You can find on my website, but the most important part is in the corner. I post each day on these three social networks all together things that I read, that I learn myself from my trainings and so on. So, good stuff. Now, Me gusta hablar con la gente. And if you have questions, I'll be more than delighted to share, to talk to you and to find about your problem and your things that you are working on. Now, I'm a community guy. I even started my own community, Bucharest Software Craftsmanship Community. You get the point. I even have a sticker on my laptop, so I'm that kind of guy. Then, oh my God, I messed it up. Come on. To start with the wrong question, with the right question, what is the most important principle in programming? Some of you now experience a moment of panic. What principles? Oh my God, no, just do your job and go home, right? So there are principles, right? Probably the most accepted one is single responsibility principle. You shouldn't have one class doing all these kind of stuff. Because first of all, this class will be huge, right? You don't want the class doing all this. Instead, you should chop it up into pieces, right? One class per task. Single responsibility principle. So don't do that, but strive for highly cohesive design. Next one, hand in hand with this cohesion stuff comes, come on, coupling. This is our system, right, in which every class depends on all the other classes, and this is a better layout of our classes. The point is not only that the changes that you do in one place will propagate, for Christ's sake, we have IntelliJ, so we will just change it and it's everywhere. But the main problem is actually how you slice it, how you test it, and how you understand it. So you want loosely coupled design, which is more testable, more easy to understand, and more easy to maintain in the end. So, coupling. Then, hand in hand with this, don't ever repeat yourself. Don't copy-paste your code. You are allowed to copy from Stack Overflow, as this book teaches us. You can copy from, but don't spread your own bugs, I mean, your own code everywhere, right? But my personal favorite is this, keep it simple. Keep it simple at all times. Whatever you do, keep your code base as simple as it can be. Don't over-engineer. Don't do stuff just because you can. Don't do that. You should have a good reason to complicate your code. Because simple code, in the end, leads to happier developers. Right? And this is a goal. This is a fundamental goal. We should have happy developers. We should protect the developers and to reduce their risk and effort by employing bits of tiny magic, like, I don't know, extensions to framework, aspects, code generators, stuff that it's there to help them, but don't force them to learn your own framework. Don't invent your framework full of bugs and have everyone in the company learn that framework. Resist that temptation, right? I normally say, after you've copy-pasted code and is in production for a year or something, then extract the framework. You should first put things in production and then extract the framework. Because it's a lot of pride involved in there. But coming back, one particular thing that helped a lot of projects I've been to is this request scope. A bin that basically carries metadata, request metadata throughout your system. With Spring, this is super simple to do. You just auto-wire my request context that you then define to be request or thread scoped. Very easy to do, simplifies a lot of signatures, but don't use this to pass business parameters, only metadata, things that all the requests in your system have. Good. Then, remember always that during the World Wars, there weren't so many masterpieces, art masterpieces written, right? Because people were shivering in fear. They were like, oh my God. So if you are scared, you will not have the creativity required to solve a problem elegantly. So by all means, employ a strong test suite that should remove the fear from your developers. And always think, always do regular brainstorms every week, every 2 weeks. What can we improve? And I mean, there are no boring tasks. People come to me and say, no, you can always automate them or get rid of them somehow. There are no boring tasks. Now, one last thing to add. Business wants to believe that as we build our software, and this is the incorrect word here, as we build our software, we are laying floor after floor in this building that you are constructing. That's false. As we all know, code is organic. Code is never laid layer on top of layer without modifying anything. So, realize that you should always care for your code continuously and try to make business understand that it's a continuous organic process. It's not just laying floors after floors, right? Now, who can predict the future? Who knows what future will become super complex in several days or weeks or months? If you can, please contact me. I'm hiring. I'm kidding. So, you can't. So the point is, if you cannot predict what will become complex. Do your best effort to keep things as simple as possible for as long as possible, right? Simple design at all times. And a simple design, first of all, passes the unit tests, right? So you should have unit tests. Then, it reveals intention, contains no duplication, and it is also minimalistic, no extra elements, right? These are the famous rules from Kent Beck, Extreme Programming Explained, fundamental rules. So, these you should always have in mind. Now, this was basically the main concepts, the principles that will come in place in this talk, because I will talk about a simple architecture which is able to evolve to match the growing functional requirements, the growing features that are added, because we cannot foresee, that's the point, that's the presumption of this talk. You cannot possibly foresee what things will go rampage and will explode in the future. Then, let's start. So, you have these entities which basically contain your persistent data, things that you normally put in some database, right? The point of with the entities is that you control them. They are under your control, and you should model them in such a way to simplify the implementation of your domain logic. The point of the entities is that they are yours to control, okay? That's the main point. Then, you should enrich these domain objects, with these entities, with bits of logic that will help you solve your business logic everywhere. What I mean by that is, for example, get full name. It's a trivial method. I call this a synthetic getter, just composing two bits together. Or maybe some state machine buried within some methods like activate, which will take care to set the activation date or in the user and stuff like that. So, little bits of logic, or this, can place orders, which is actually a tiny business rule that can be very, very nicely used with Java 8 four dots notation. Things that can make your life a lot easier, or if you are using GPA, to make sure that you are setting the both ends of your bidirectional relationships. These kind of things you can put in your entities, guard them there, and build a strong entity model. Now, be careful not to put a lot of domain logic in there, because this might, you should never do that in your entities, because this is a CSV formatting. This has no place in an entity. This is garbage, right? And be careful not to pollute your entities with a lot of view-related or very specific kind of logic for a single use case. In your entities, there should be highly reusable tiny bits of logic. Good. But then, there are other objects in place besides your entities. There are value objects which are spread among your entities. Basically, these are a grouping of data that moves together through your system. Very simple stuff. They are small, very, very tiny objects which are best to be built immutable. Whether you're using Lombok or not, this is a highly debated topic. I won't go into there. But the point is that you can validate those entities and make sure they are never constructed in an invalid state. And such, be always sure that your value objects will remain valid throughout their lives, because you cannot possibly change those values. Now, compared to entities, value objects don't have an ID. If you compare two value objects, you should compare them field by field, each one in turn. So very quick run over these concepts. Then, value objects, as many people say, are probably one of the best unused features, actually, of modeling data. We are in this mindset of always modeling entities. And one thing you could try out tomorrow is to try to break down your large entities into smaller pieces and use embeddables if you are using an ORM, or basically decompose them into substructures and then put them together in one piece in your entity. So, value objects are are super critical for building an expressive and simple domain model. But then, the next day, you should start exposing data to your user interface, right? And whatever technology you use, they will have different goals. First of all, they will want data structure like these, to extract the customer name, the last order date, okay, the region, all these came from different entities. Realize that? Then total order of priorities is an aggregation over things and response. This grouping of data has nothing to do with our entity model, actually. So trying to match, trying to fit our entity model to expose in your API will just make your entity model suffer. And one more example, if they need this is deletable flag in order to display the delete button, you know? Should I put the delete button in the screen or not? And they ask from you a Boolean to tell them that. You should not put that in your entities because these pollute your entities. So, in short, you should never expose your sacred entities to your clients, because at that moment your client will become the owner, the master of your entities. Even though the problem is that at the first stages of the project, the API model and the entity model are basically identical. And very often people are just, oh, look, they are the same. Let's just expose. Don't do that. Instead, give them data transfer objects, which basically is a different data model. These are the kinds that you can work with. Form that comes from the user interface view, DTOs moves both sides, and so on. This is an example of a DTO, right? It has private fields and public getters and setters. Oh, this is P-O-O-O-O-P, sorry. So my position is simple as that. I like dumb DTOs. I will make public fields. Oh my God. I know what you're all thinking of now. It goes like this. Is a sonar, right? Sonar will cry. But this, if you let sonar win, it is like in Matrix, the victory of machines over humans, right? These are tools. We should use our tools, not be used by our tools. So tune the rules you have in sonar. It is yours to control. If you have good reasons, and I have good reasons, you will see in a couple of slides why I don't want any kind of method in my DTOs. Nice. Then you start building your logic, right? So you start implementing the first use case. The first use case has, of course, to convert the data from the user data structures to the internal entity model. So you should convert things using such code, which I assume none of you is very, very big fan of writing. You did not get hired to write this kind of code, I'm almost certain. So then, what should you do? You want to hide that misery somewhere. So one way to hide there is to put it in the constructor of the DTO. That's fine. Your DTOs, your miserable DTOs, can depend on the holy entities. Okay? So it's okay. Not the other way around, for Christ's sake. No. But this is okay. But then if this mapping requires some external dependencies, or perhaps it's so complex, you can put it in a separate class, maybe, and extract it away from the rest of your domain logic, from the rest of your application logic. Now, extract when it grows. The first time we see this principle. When something grew big, extract it in a separate class. But then you start writing your first use case. Now, this will be probably a bit of a surprise for some of you. I will write my entire logic for a use case in a facade. In a facade, all there. Okay, so the entire implementation in the facade. But then, at some point, I will notice that some use cases are so trivial that they just require two or three calls, and that's it. And then those use cases will remain as methods in those facades. Other use cases will grow very big, right? And as they grow big, I will extract them to domain services and mind the colors. These are yellow, the color of joy, right? Have you seen the Inside Out movie? It's the color of joy, folks. Whereas facades are orangish, reddish, yeah. Then, when things grew big, I extracted. Also, if there was some bits of logic which was required by two facades, I would also extract them in a separate domain service and so on, with the purpose of keeping things, of not duplicating things. So these two purposes, simplifying logic or removing the application, are the reasons to extract a domain service. But now, the question is, these yellow domain services will speak the language of my sweet entity model. There will be no user data data structures there, no details, nothing, only my sacred entity model. That's what I want to see, and that's why they are yellow. But then the facade will take DTOs, so the first thing it should do is to convert them. But be aware not to build a lot of logic on top of your DTOs, because the DTOs are controlled by your clients, actually. They are fragile. And that's why I don't want any kind of methods in my DTOs, because those DTOs will change tomorrow. And my logic there will just break because things were added, or I don't know. So I don't want logic built on top of my DTOs. So the first thing I should do is to convert those DTOs to my holy domain model and then work with that. That's the essence of things. When things are complicated, they should never be implemented on top of data structures you don't control. If you just have to do some conversions, some boring stuff, then you can work with that DTOs. But no business rules, no hardcore stuff. Now, there are some applications that don't have brains. You need to realize when your application doesn't have brains, in which moment you don't necessarily need the domain model. But that's another story. I'm talking here about large applications full of business rules as we normally have. Now, let's recap. What are the roles of a facade? The facade will convert the data. When the conversion grows too big, I will pull it away in a mapper. The facade also implements the domain logic. When the domain logic for a use case is too big, I will extract it in domain services. Of course, since the facade works with structures that come from outside, it needs to validate the structure. So the validation is also there, but if the validation grows too big, then extract it away, perhaps. I will also impose one more rule, which is the facades never call each other. This is a deep rule, a very, very, very interesting discussion about that. I would just take it for granted for now, just don't call between them. If I impose this rule, I can be sure that a use case will only enter, how many of you are working with Spring? Spring, yes, okay. If I impose this rule, I can be sure that any use case will go through at most one proxy. Huh? Aspects, proxy. Transactional, huh? Then this means that I can weave aspects on the facades and be sure that they are executed just once per use case. I have, for example, in my project, facade logging interceptor. Guess what it does? Huh? Facade logging interceptor. So I have disadvantages if I have this facade. Global session handling, stuff like that, I can do there in the facade. People ask me afterwards, what comes in front of the facade? There are the controllers, of course. But the controllers are so thin that I don't care about them. They are one line per method. Just delegate one-to-one to a method in a facade. Good, then extract when it grows. The second time we saw, actually, a lot of times we've extracted things. So what do I mean by that? When a class grows too big, I take 200 lines as an example. I don't know, maybe 250, not 1,000, no. Then I break it up. How? Well, I look for a name to summarize a part of its method. And then I extract. That's it. Sounds very, very easy, right? I mean, what's that difficult? Just look for a name. Yes, indeed, seems like a piece of cake, but but actually you realize there are only two things hard in programming, right? Caching validation and naming things. Because when you are looking for a name in this place, then in that place, you are actually sniffing for a new responsibility. You are trying to detect that a new responsibility was born inside the same class. Now, what I mean is that you should apply single responsibility principle on demand to simplify things. Don't just make classes of 10 lines each just because you think they have different responsibilities. Use CRP as a way to break up things when they grow too big. I've seen too many projects with classes of 20 lines per class, and people were rioting, we don't want to work in this, because it was a hell, thousands of classes, right? That's not what I like to do, really. Again, the point of the talk is for you not to agree with me. That's the whole point. I want to challenge you in different ways, and I'll be more than glad to discuss nuances and the reasons for it depends afterwards. Good, now. A quick example, if this class grew too big, I then start looking at it, and I realize that the second part of that has to do with preferences, right? The customer preferences, validate address, things which are in his profile. So what do? I break it up into two classes, split it horizontally. Horizontally because the client, the class which originally called the customer facade, now will call the customer preferences facade. This is why it's horizontal. On the same layer of abstraction. What the heck is this? On the same layer of abstraction. Horizontally. What is he doing with his hands? Horizontally. And if there is a horizontal break, there should be also a vertical one, right? The vertical extraction goes like this. If you have an order service which requires some functionality, which is also needed by the delivery service, you might as well extract it as a dependency of yourself. That's the difference. You depend on the newly extracted class. I did that to reuse a bit of logic. I can also do that if I find that from a business process, some part of it is very complex, and then it deserves a separate class to simplify its implementation. So the point is, you can apply this vertical extraction for eliminating duplication or simplifying things. That's a lot more difficult to do than just copy-pasting Control-X moving method. That's a lot difficult to do, and a lot difficult to refactor the unit tests if you do that. You will have a decision, should I put mocks in between or not? Tough one. Sometimes yes, sometimes no. It depends if the API is stable, because if you put mocks, on API, it freezes the API. At the moment it goes, then half of your tests break, because you should put mocks only on stable APIs. This, my friends, is actually an application of separation by layers of abstraction, because the light blue ones are a bit more high level than the dark blue ones, if I may. The point is, they are on different layers of abstraction. Tough one. Now, duplication can be caused by rush. Yes? Can be required. You should validate again the data on the backend side, no matter whether you validated it in the front end, of course. You know how a very interesting career can start, right? With F12. Right click, copy as CURL. There's a whole career waiting for you if you're. Yes. A very, let's not go into details, but there are other reasons for duplicating things. Because you just forgot you did it two months ago, or perhaps you never knew someone else did it. This is critical in large projects. So what you should do instead is to increase the bus factor. You know about the bus factor, right? The number of people in a team that should be whacked for the project to be in deep, smelly problems. So it should not be one, right? If there is one single developer knowing everything, and the project depends on one single developer, if that guy misses, okay. Now, the solution for these two actually is to do pair programming. And also, the entire stuff of refactoring, of retrofitting, of extracting, these seem simple on the slide, but they aren't, as you know. Especially the vertical ones and breaking up classes can be, just imagine breaking up a class of 10,000 lines. Huh? It took 2 years to do that. Okay, so what did you do to practice? Katas, hackathons. Then mob programming, coding dojos, and but more importantly, pair programming. This is the fundamental, and I mean, almost all of you have tried, and I really like that. Now, pair programming, reasons that I do it. It's fun, better design, less bugs, more passion. If you are alone, mira una chica. Then it's easy. If I call you to come here, I want to teach you something. Come here, help me with something. You will come immediately, right? And by subliminally, I will deliver things. Look what I do. Control Alt M. Hey, look there. Hey, Control F6. And I will teach you stuff, right? Without you knowing that. And I really love that. Then put your I type 3 times faster when someone is next to me. 3 times faster. I've measured it. 3 times faster, right? So it puts my pride to work, which is incredible. It puts the most important sin, right? The most important, it puts it to work, right? Because he or she is looking. It's human, right? Then team building. What team building if you are spending the whole day right next to that guy and talking continuously, right? What code review? What code review if I saw everything? We have a pig, a small pig, that if we squeeze, it goes like, and if someone pushes that pig, then it means that she or he needs some second opinion. So immediately we group next to that guy. We even invented the concept. I'm not sure if we invented it. It's called the grape programming. You know how a grape looks? Like this, right? Like this. So here is the monitor, and these are the guys. Right? They just group and group and group, and we end up 8 people on one monitor. They're just looking on demand. You know? Then cheaper. Actually, this is debatable, but actually, C2.com has a proof of about that. Something with 15% slower, but 15% less bugs. So in the end, it's cheaper actually on the long term. Now let's go to the second part, because developer comfort is essential for being able to create and to invent and to use and to resolve problems with elegance. Now, what do you think is wrong with this t-shirt? Come on. What's wrong? What? An N, of course. So stupidity always comes hand in hand with pride. If you find a guy wearing this t-shirt working your open space, you should go to the nearest gas station. Also buy some light, E equals MC squared, light, and then give him light. The problem is not only he's stupid, but he's also bragging. Yeah, ivory tower architect, just tear him down. This refuses communication, refuses discussion. And whenever someone closes the communication, you should have serious doubts about that guy. Because the best code is the code that you've been talking about, that you've been arguing, debating about, right? The worst project I ever did, I wrote it myself, alone, in a summer, where all the guys were in holidays, and I wrote, it's the worst project I ever wrote. I had no one to argue with. Okay, in this happy tone, let's talk about the most advanced architecture in the world, the onion architecture, yes. So if you have some code that you want to protect, you will put it in the middle, in the domain module, in the domain fortress, let's say. You will put there the domain services, which, remember, were extracted from the most complex use cases of your system. Only those grew big and became a domain service. Also, entities should be in there, of course. They are your holy language, actually. But then, this is the fortress that you want to defend. In front of that, of course, is the user. And in front of the user, you dig this trench, and you put their facades, validators, things that are polluted with what the user actually needs, with what the user interface actually requires. So, but then, what happens if from the domain... Ah, no, one more thing. If you structure the dependencies like this, tell me one thing, the DTOs from here, will they be able to enter your fortress? The dependency goes like this. So in your domain, when you hit compulsively control space, you will not see the classes here. Realize that? These are invisible in the domain because of the direction of the dependencies. These, imagine there are 2 Maven modules, right? And they depend, this one depends on the domain. If in the domain you hit control space, there will be no DTO in there. So DTOs will be kept out, and this is a good thing. But then what happens if from your domain you need to call some external services? Well, if you call an external service, it will come hand in hand with a set of DTOs of its own. Its own API model will come to you. Do you guys know what LDAP is? LDAP. You get the user from LDAP, yeah? And you request a user. And here comes the user. It has 60 fields. Oh my God, what do I do? I can take that and pass it to the next method. But if you see a method taking a parameter, like an object with 60 fields, you'll be like, oh my God, what happens there? You know? What you should do instead, you should convert those 60 fields to only extract those 3 fields that you need, probably, and make a value object on top of that and pass it around. So you should not tolerate the DTOs in your yellow domain fortress. So when you call it, however, you need somehow to, if you call a method, you need to import that method. As soon as you do that, you will become dependent, and basically the DTOs can now enter your domain, which is not good. That's why I will pull it out and make around it an infrastructure domain, an infrastructure module. That infrastructure module will also contain an adapter, which is the good old adapter from the Gang of Four. The same point is to hide their API, to handle exceptions, convert those DTOs, validate the data, normal stuff that you do when you call something which is ugly, right? Then, however, if the layout looks like this, your domain needs to import the infrastructure module. And as soon as you do that, you are back at the first problem, because now the domain can still see the DTOs from the right part. Realize that. You import the classes. As soon as you do that, you also see the DTOs in there. So what should I do next? Oh my God. Oh my God. What's that? I've peeled the onion, right? I've peeled the onion, and I've extracted A. What's that? Come on. I've taken right? How is it called? Saboya? No. I've taken the API of that class and extracted it in a what? In a? Interface, exactly. It's an interface that I've put in my domain. That interface will be implemented by the adapter, but as soon as you do that, just realize what just happened here. Let's come back to the first. Oh my God. Oh my God. Whoa. 15 minutes I've worked on that, so let's do it again. My God. But it's more, there's more. Look, look, look. Look how happy she. Another 10 minutes. Look, look. So the point is the dependency just got inverted. So to put it in words, when from your domain logic you need something from outside, you first express your need in an interface, yellow interface, joyful interface that gives you an order of your own and only works primitives and entities. Then this is the holy domain. Then comes the infrastructure, the miserable surroundings, which needs to implement the holy interface and do the necessary stuff, conversions and so on, with the ultimate purpose of having an interface which is talking in the language of my domain. Now, to put this, to realize what really happens, the call will go at runtime from the domain service to the adapter, although the code dependency goes the other way around. You realize that? Let me zoom again. Look how joyful she is. Okay, so then to put it in a more formal context, this is actually the dependency inversion, V, the inversion principle, which says the higher level logic should not depend on miserable stuff. IO exception, file not found. What are these? You know, you should abstract those away and make sure they never enter your domain. Or LDAP user with 60 fields, don't use that in your domain. If you do that, your data structures from the reddish, orangish, what's the color, it will never enter your domain. Now, Uncle Bob says this is the best thing OOP gave us. I don't necessarily agree with him, but still is a valuable thing to have in our toolset, right? You can do that whenever you want to call out using some data structures that you don't control. Whenever, these are actually the four integration patterns, the four integration paradigms that you can use. Synchronous calls, asynchronous messaging, file transfer, or database links. These four things, you can always employ dependency inversion to protect your domain from those. With the ultimate purpose of building an agnostic domain, and a domain that doesn't depend on any structures outside your fortress, right? And it's very easy. It's easier to reason when you don't need to care about the LDAP user with 60 fields, right? Good. Now, what you should do? So again, you should put the interfaces for the adapters that we've just extracted there. Maybe you should put some interfaces for the repositories, only if those interfaces have implementation of your own. What I mean here is, if you are using some Spring Data GPA, if you are using GPA actually, then you will talk in the language of your own domain. That is, you don't need to extract the implementation of that. In my opinion, this is what I. So the interface for the repository and for the adapter should be placed in the domain. Then you have application in front of your domain. You will extract the implementation of those adapters. You will extract, if you need, do you get the point? If perhaps you are using GDBC, why not? Then you have the implementation in the domain and the miserable results, outside here. That's what I mean. Then probably you will also maybe have some batch. And this is actually the onion architecture, also called hexagonal or Portson adapters. They just keep reinventing it every 5 years. They put it in a new name and they rebrand it, and there you go. The point is, what's blinking? The arrows are blinking. The domain doesn't depend on anything. The other stuff depends on the domain. Good. Now, because I am a bit, so again, you have in front of you, you have enemies there, and sometimes enemies here. That's why you put not null, right? Because here comes the DBA, null, right? So, because I'm a lazy guy, I merge everything together in a single application module. So I only have two modules, and I call this the pragmatic onion. Yes. It works for projects of reasonable size. It won't work for projects of 10 years with 80 people developing. No, it won't work there. But for large projects, it still works. Two modules, domain and application surrounding it, right? And the principle is to, whenever I have logic which is complex, I should extract it, pull it inside my domain, keep it safe, keep it in a warm place, in a testable environment, right? Don't just let heavy logic and business rules exist outside. One more discussion I'd like to have with you. How do you name your packages? I know how heatedly debated is this topic. I know how many useless arguments are done on that, but I just want to make one point here. Call my org my app, and then comes probably, as I've told you, first aid domain infrastructure. Just overview. If you do that after several years of developing, you will see that you have a lot of classes in your domain package, right? You will have 20, 30 classes there. So then what would you do? You would like to break it up into pieces. One idea would be to break it in a sub package, like domain.order, domain.product. Do you follow the point? And group those entities in sub packages. But at the next moment you realize, wait a second. Why don't I do this on a larger scale? Meaning that probably in a couple of days or weeks, you will like to break this up into pieces too, and then this up into pieces. At which moment you will find, like, what the heck happens, right? I mean, and here comes Uncle Bob saying, talking about the clean architecture. The point, when you open a code base, the architecture should not express the technical decisions, should not name the technical layers you've invented yourself. The architecture, the package names should be guided by domain purpose. So, what do I mean? I take an axe, and crack everything in two, right? Everything, but in such a dramatic way that I name all the packages starting with order. You realize what happens? Come my org, my app dot order dot facade, domain infrastructure, right? Right there, I break it up. So I will end up with two little onions, huh? Two little onions. Do you know there is this kind of onion, a small one that if you plant, it will grow into a big one. You know, how many of you are doing agriculture? Kidding. But if you to get a big onion, you need to plant small onions. I don't know the term, the official term, but this is what I mean here. I have two little onions, little, in a single code base, a single Git, a single Maven module, yet. Then, so folks, pay attention. This is the last hardcore slide. Pay attention. It is a super difficult task, slide. What happens next? I will break the monolith. Oh my God. So how many of you are trying to break a monolith right now? Oh yes. This is one idea. Look, what can happen. First question, those of you who are breaking it up, are you allowed to call from to refer from an entity in one little onion, an entity from the other onion? What do you think? Are you allowed to keep a link, a dependency between those two? No, you shouldn't. Then, are you allowed to call methods from one domain to another? Again, so no, we are stretching our mind now. So again, what are you doing? We're literally, technically building two projects in a single Git source, in a single repository. So we have two wannabe applications, two little onions, right, in the same package, in the same code base. So you should not call that. Instead of calling directly the domain, you should go to your infra, perhaps go to a DTO and to that guy's facade. Makes sense? You should. Whoa. Yeah, okay, we can do that. We can do that, perhaps. But then what happens with the transactions? So now I'm shooting at you some really deep topics. Deep, like whoa. Okay? Just shooting at you. Just some random ideas. Food for thought. You should not have spanned transactions that wrap both onions. You should not have two onions in one transaction. Instead of a transaction, you should probably throw an event and let the event propagate. If you don't know Spring Events, the publisher, right? Just throw an event to the other onion. Why? And what happens if you do that? You will lose consistency. At the moment in which you don't have the two inserts in a single transaction, you technically abandon consistency because you know what can go wrong, right? Just to have one transaction in one onion succeed and the other one fail. You feel the emptiness in your right now. And then what? And then compensation handlers and Gundam style. Here comes the, yeah. So, yeah. Then you have the schema, right? And most projects that I've seen when they are struggling to break up the monolith, they just died when they reached the database. You know? They've chopped the tree, and then they've ended into the roots. Have you ever tried cutting a tree from the ground completely? The most difficult part is to pull out the, how's it called? The roots. So just breaking up the part which is outside visible, it's easy. But when you reach the database, then you need to bring the, how's it called? The machine. Tiny. So the database will give you the most pain because you need to kill the foreign keys. If you do that, you are again shivering, right? But then you will need to replicate at some point and you'll need to copy some data from one part to another. Then you will also probably need select to span both onions, which is actually technically allowed, but what? Where are we heading to? Come on, where are you heading to? Oh my God. Ah. Ah. Yeah. But still, if the events are sent within and transactions are broken up, if we don't have foreign keys, if we don't have calls between the domains, we can just cut here, you know? Just cut here, and there you go, you have two systems. And this is the way that I recommend to grow as a monolith and then at some point break it up into pieces. Ooh, this takes 3 to 5 years. Huh? Good. Now, one thing that you may not have known of is this arcunit.org that allows you to put rules that will check that, read for yourself. Classes that reside in package service should only be accessible from package controller. And guess what? This is a JUnit that will fail in case you break the rule. Nice, huh? So check this out, arcunit.org. I'm kind of out of time, so I'll be rushing a bit. Again, with the point of nurturing your garden. Do you know what that is? This is the most resilient organism in the universe. It can resist an atomic bomb. It can resist in outer space. It is a tardigrade or a water bear. The point of this, why did I brought it here, is that evolution only happens under constraints, right? You need to put some constraints in place. And I recommend you reading this wonderful book from Neil Ford, Building Evolutionary Architectures, which actually tells you how to build some fitness functions that can. Do you remember the genetic algorithms from faculty with populations and fitness functions and evolutions? This is basically trying to put some guidelines on how to evolve in a controlled way your architecture. Okay, with the test, I will just skip completely with that. I will just... What? No? Ah, you are still a test. No, I won't skip it. Okay, go. It's very easy, actually. The first test you will build are the most difficult, because they will give you the most honest feedback about your design. And that's why they are so hard to write on legacy code, right? The next tests that you will write, you will build you'll give you confidence in the future, regression defense. The most sweet tests that we have are functions, functional tests. What I mean here is no mocks, huh? Mock-free tests, huh? Mock-free test. Good, the next one are mock-based, then you can emulate things in memory like an H2, and the worst kind of tests from a maintainability point of view are those which talk with external systems, real external systems. You should strive always to write your logic in such a way to be testable as a pure function. And this is the separation we've done, infrastructure and domain. Now what I suggest is that inside your domain, you will isolate, as Venkat says, a circle of purity, in which you should draw the most complex part of your logic and push the dependencies and side effects out, in the domain, but out, to isolate the most complex part of your system. And there's another talk that I had, unit testing like a pro, the circle of purity, in which I talk in more detail about that. It's on YouTube. Books, exactly. Okay, key points. Now, with the essence is to keep it simple at all points. Keep it simple at all moments, right? Avoid over-engineering. Do magic to protect your developers, but don't force them to learn your framework. Modeling data, you need to realize that there is enemy data out there that you should be careful about, because it's under the control of your UI. Then, logic. You should extract it when it grows. Be always prepared to create a new class. Please do that. Right-click, new class. 3 times per day when you return from the restroom. You wash your hands, right-click, new class. The onion, dependency inversion principle. Keep your domain agnostic from the miseries, right? And with tests, actually, listen to your tests and let them smash your design and strive for a testable design. Not hundreds and thousands of unit tests, but more importantly, testable design. James Coplian. Google him. Good. So keep it simple at all times. That would be the most important lesson. And also put passion in all that you do. Good. Thank you all. Thank you very much.